People are strange when you're a stranger. Faces look ugly when you're alone. Women seem wicked when you're unwanted. Streets are uneven when you're down, when you're strange. Faces come out of the rain when you're strange, when you're strange, when you're strange.
Good afternoon, I'm Carly Yuck.
And I'm Jordan Amore. Welcome to Outside the Box. It is Thursday, April 7th. Today on our show, we will explore the outer limits of the universe, take a look at performers who are pushing their own limits, and speak with women who are working to challenge society's common misconceptions.
There's a new group in Montreal promoting sex workers' rights.
L'Alliance Féministe Solidaire is working in collaboration with Stella and other organizations to push for the decriminalization of sex work in Quebec. The group held a launching party March 18th at the Théâtre Sainte-Catherine. The launch featured a panel discussion highlighting the importance of decriminalization in the fight against violence towards women. All four panelists said that the criminalization of prostitution raises the risk of violence among women. Also, while prostitution is legal in Canada, measures to ensure the safety of sex workers is minimal. Not everyone agrees. The Concertation des Luttes contre l'Exploitation Sexuelle is another Montreal group. They say that the decriminalization of prostitution is not the answer, and that there are better ways to eradicate abuse among women.
Reporter Jesse Matheson spoke with another person fighting for women's rights and sexual freedom. Giselle Lullaby is a drag queen and a feminist. She performed in a fundraiser at Cabaret Mado to raise money for a group of interns from the organization called Alternative. The interns will be using the money to shoot documentaries on women's rights in Ecuador. Let's see what she has to say.
Before stepping on stage, Giselle Lullaby transforms herself into a walking statement.
For me, it takes 30 minutes to wear makeup, put the makeup, and 10 minutes to...
When she steps into the spotlight, she represents a movement known as transfeminism. Lullaby and other transgendered individuals are part of a growing number of transfeminists who promote acceptance and equality of everyone.
Je pense que c'est important que le monde voit que les femmes ont besoin d'être pas indépendantes mais d'être égaux.
In tonight's show, she and four other drag queens went on stage for a cause they all support, the movement for women's rights.
Que oui, je suis un féministe et
She says drag queens represent women of all shapes and sizes, from the powerful, affirmed women to the Gucci girls of the world. For tonight's performance, she was the promiscuous bad girl of the show. The proceeds from Ecuador, por favor, will fund the Alternative's trip to Ecuador to shoot documentaries on women's rights. One of the interns, Anouk Renaud, was happy to host a fundraiser at Cabaret Mado.
J'aime les drags en général, c'est toujours des soirées cool.
And Lullaby was glad to help raise money for Anouk's cause.
The power of the woman, yeah!
For Outside the Box, I'm Jesse Matheson.
Did you know only one woman in all of Canada has a job of investigating fires? She works for a community of almost 100,000 people on the south shore of Montreal. And if a fire broke out in your house or office, you'd want her on your side. Our reporter Genevieve Trudeau met her to find out more about this risky job.
So we're here today with Prevention and Fire Investigation Technician Nathalie Michaud from Saint-Jean-sur-Richelieu. Nathalie, could you explain to us what exactly is your job here?
In fire investigation, you have to understand fire development to be able to look at a building and basically recreate it, but from destroyed to new, basically. And our job is exactly to do that, to determine the cause. And with that, we can actually do statistics. If the fire has really started touching the structure, and what we mean by that is countertops, ceiling, the roof, the walls, anything that is basically a construction material to hold the building together, then yes, we will be called in.
You were a firefighter before. What got you interested in the other side of the mirror?
Honestly, I was working in an office before as a full-time job, and it was just one of those things where you're just, you feel you're not at your place. And I got the opportunity to hear about the class of prevention that was being given to become a technician. And I just took a chance at 35 years old. I went back to school full time and did my prevention technician class. And it really, really, truly is my field. I love it. You meet people, you get to explain to them what's going on, you get to actually make a difference. Is it dirty? Yeah, you know, it's you're walking in ashes and a structure that sometimes is not that solid. Sometimes you're working by yourself. Weird hours because you have to be on call. And, you know, you come home and you smell like smoke. It's like being a firefighter, except you're not fighting the fire.
How is it being the first woman fire investigator in Canada?
When I first started, it was very, very difficult to get the respect when I showed up on scene. You know, it's 2 o'clock in the morning and, you know, you're still like this because you're tired. They've been fighting the fire for, I don't know, maybe an hour, 2 hours. And you're 5'2" and you're the one in control of the scene all of a sudden. Not their chief, you. And you're the chick. So, yeah. You're new, you haven't proven yourself yet, and if you were to ask some assistance or some help, nope, you don't get it. But, you know, as time goes by, like anything else and in any other job, treat everybody and your colleagues with respect, and you will get it. I believe that the whole, you know, first woman doing this type of job, It had to happen, and it happened to be me, so great. And I really do hope that there will be more, because it really is an amazing job. It really, really, if you like to get down and dirty and stinky and all that stuff, yeah, it's really great.
I'm Genevieve Trudeau, reporting Outside the Box.
Jordan, do you find it hard to breathe out here?
Well, yeah, Carly, that's because we're on the moon.
Oh, yeah, we are on the moon. Do you think anyone lives out here?
Well, I'm not sure, but I spoke with people on Earth and they seem to be pretty convinced.
UFO and the existence of alien life forces are subjects that many people are divided on. One group devoted to debunking this myth gather once a month at Al Raouche restaurant in Montreal North to eat, discuss sightings, and present PowerPoints of research done in the past month. The group is called the Association Québécoise d'Ufologie. We had the chance to sit through one of the meetings. Some of the speakers didn't permit us to record their presentations, though, so we had a one-on-one with the group's president, Gilles Milo, in the meantime. He spoke to us about the group's purpose.
C'est pas qu'on peut-être croit que ça se passe. Comme moi, l'autre département, la préparation au Québec, on cherche le côté scientifique des phénomènes paranormaux. Hey, c'est intéressant, Jupiter, là. Donc, je m'intéresse aux phénomènes paranormaux. Ça veut pas dire que je crois qu'il y a des mots qui viennent habiter une personne. Je crois qu'il y a d'autres choses. On a eu des expériences, on a fait des enquêtes, là. Écoute, mais c'est quoi le côté scientifique qui a permis ça? C'est ça, moi, c'est ma passion. Ça, c'est ma passion avec le côté ufologique, ça. Trouver toute la bibitte en dessous de ça. Puis avec les découvertes en physique quantique, tu t'aperçois qu'il y a beaucoup de choses spéciales, beaucoup d'explications.
One man, who didn't want to be identified or filmed, told the story of an alien encounter. He was playing cards with his brothers one night when something fiery fell from the sky. They thought it was a meteor, so they went to investigate. Along the way, the man said he stood 2 meters from something bizarre, not human. Along with his brothers, the man described what he saw to a sketched artist, and this is what he saw. He claims that this image is 90% accurate. To this day, that image haunts him and has made skeptics think, are we really alone? On Thursday, September 30th, 2010, there was a reported unidentified flying object in Côte Saint-Luc. David Schwartz saw the alleged UFO.
We thought maybe it was a plane, but planes only have 2 bright lights on both sides of the wing. This was actually more of like a 4-square, where it was just 4 like small lights in the sky, like spread apart. And then out of nowhere, it would completely cross section and the lights would completely switch over.
With all the groups around Quebec devoted to finding extraterrestrial life forms, and even with the alleged UFO sightings in Montreal, there still isn't any concrete proof or certainty of alien existence. Nonetheless, these researchers will continue their path to proving many of the skeptics wrong. I'm Jordan Damore, thinking outside the box.
Thanks, Jordan. Now let's see what Montrealers have to say about the topic.
I sure do believe in aliens.
Why?
Because I think as human beings, it would be not only very pretentious, but preposterous to think that in this whole universe, we're the only living beings on this in this world.
Honestly, I think we're like the alien species on Earth.
What do you think about life on other planets? Do you think it exists?
Yeah, I bet there is life on other planets, but I think that we're aliens.
Like all those alien spottings, I don't know. Yeah, I don't think so.
Of course, it's a known fact. It's been known for thousands of years.
How so?
Well, the greatest structures ever created on Earth, the pyramids, have the whole story written, carved in stone to last forever for all humanity to see till the end of time, if you will.
It seems that while most Montrealers believe there is life on other planets, they're torn on whether or not they've come to ours. For Outside the Box, I'm Bianca David.
Stefan Link has joined us on the moon to discuss the extent of our scientific knowledge of the universe and what lies beyond our limits. Stefan has a bachelor's in physics and was the president of the McGill Society of Physics students. Let's begin with what physicists know about the universe. Stefan, can you give us an idea on how big the universe is?
Yeah, well, if you start with our star, that's one of many stars. There's about 200 billion stars in the Milky Way galaxy. Now, our galaxy is just one of many. There's about 100 billion galaxies estimated in our universe. And now recent theories of string theory, also inflationary model, all the mathematics leads to the fact that there's not only one universe, but infinite amount of universes.
But how do scientists search for aliens?
There's all sorts of ways that they can search for aliens. They search for alternative life forms here on Earth. So they've recently found bacteria that can live in just arsenic. They've also found microorganisms that live in these ultra-hot vents in the bottom of the oceans. And now these microorganisms could theoretically survive a journey on a comet through space. So that's one possible origin of life. They also look for life on Mars with rovers. There's two rovers currently looking right now for NASA, and they're planning future trips in 2011, also in 2018. There's also SETI, which looks for communications of intelligent life forms. They search for radio waves and try to find a signal that's different from noise. And if they ever found a signal that was really distinct, they'd think that something intelligent probably created that signal.
That aliens have come to Earth?
No, there's actually no proof whatsoever that aliens have ever come to Earth whatsoever. I kind of think of it a little bit like pseudoscience, because we've never had any hard evidence of any actual intelligent life form visiting Earth. I mean, there's been a whole bunch of stories and stuff, but I'd be skeptical of anybody who tries to tell you something without giving you actual concrete evidence. They've tried with photos and all this stuff, but almost all of that has been discarded as fake and or natural phenomena. So
even though there's no solid proof that aliens have come to Earth, is there still a possibility that there is life out there?
Absolutely. It seems almost a sure thing that there would be another planet with ideal conditions orbiting a star that would allow for intelligent life as we know it to come to be. But now there's arguments from people such as Stephen Hawking, which say that it's not necessarily a good thing to try to communicate with another intelligent life form, because there's no reason that they would be diplomatic or nice in any way. Like some people think that if they were out there and they found out about us, they would either leave us alone or come to take all our resources.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for joining us today.
Well, thank you for having me. I've got to run now, though, or else I'll miss my flight back to Earth.
That was a long trip. Those flights to the moon have terrible service, but I'm glad to be back in the studio.
Yeah, me too. And now it's time for our daily art segment.
Today we will look at some inspiring performers and quirky artists. First, we go to Tanya Mosin, who spoke to artist April Anna. Anna is all about beauty, purity, and colors. She is a one-of-a-kind artist. Like others, she paints fairy tales and dreams, but her canvas is the human body. Let's take a look.
April Anna is an artist of many talents. At 32, she already counts two contracts with Le Cercle du Soleil. Anna says she can't choose which form of art she likes best, but she admits that there is something special about body painting.
What I like about body painting is that it's a journey and an interactive experience with my canvas.
The cost of brushes and special painting pots at $30 each make of body painting a somewhat expensive art. Anna documented her 15 years of experience in a book of her own 2 years ago. Her boyfriend, Sigmund Liam, says he wasn't a big fan of any kind of body transformation before meeting Anna. His opinion has now changed.
It's like, after a while, you sort of get into character and start, you know, actually feeling like you're the actual character that they're being painted as. A tiger is usually what I get transformed into, but I've been turned into fantasy creatures also.
With at least half a dozen body painters like Anna in Montreal, it is hard to really make money out of it, she says. Body painting can take any time between 15 minutes to several hours depending on the surface to cover. It is also important for her that she keeps practicing even when there are no contracts. Competition in this small business is fierce.
I think some of that's because it's so difficult to get work that some people feel threatened by other body painters. And so they're a little bit of a catty vibe.
Anna works on various events and regularly participates to contests around the province. I am Tanya Mosen, reporting Outside the Box.
Now we will look at another art form that uses a different kind of canvas.
Yarn bombers may sound alarming, but they are actually part of a peaceful guerrilla movement that has gained momentum in North America. The colorful fiber art tags sprinkle the streets of Montreal, but their purpose is not permanence. Yarn bombers aim to personalize overlooked or forgotten city structures in a less offensive way. University of Alberta student Kelta Coomer is vying to bring a yarn bombing festival to cities across Canada. Her idea is rated 32nd in the Pepsi Refresh Project in Arts and Culture. The winner will receive funding for the realization of his or her plan. To vote for the yarn bombing, go to www.refresheverything.ca/guerrilla-knitting.
A Montreal breakdancer is breaking free from the binds of his disability. Luca Patuelli formed the Ill Abilities crew to inspire others with similar limitations to overcome them. Jesse Matheson has more on this.
Mark Briffaut has been breakdancing for as long as he can remember.
Since the days of watching Ninja Turtles or whatever, we would practice our moves.
When he first saw Lazy Legs hit the floor, he knew there was a new dancer on the Montreal scene.
He made a big, bang when he appeared on the scene.
Briffaut and his crew recruited Patuelli 2 years later. Then, in 2007, Patuelli founded the Ill Abilities crew of four disabled dancers. Mark, being fully abled, is the executive stagehand for the group.
Our goal is to inspire, motivate, entertain.
The Ill Abilities members definitely meet that goal. Chico from Chile was born with his feet at his knees. Tommy Guns is from San Francisco. He was born fully able, but developed osteosarcoma. Doctors told him he had to replace his bones with metal or amputate. He decided to amputate and pursue a breaking career. Cujo may appear fully abled, but he was born deaf in one ear and very limited in the other. He must feel the vibrations of the music to dance. Ill Abilities is hosting a 2-day event next month. The preliminary qualifications are on the 14th, and the main event is at Club Soda on the 15th.
This is an all-ages, all-abilities event.
The newest member, Raidu, will be flying in from Holland to meet the crew and make his first appearance with them. Reporting from Outside the Box, I'm Jesse Matheson.
Taking on an acting career at over 60? That's what seven volunteers from the town of Cowansville have been commissioned to do with the governmental program New Horizons for Seniors. Karine Guillet reports.
Last November, these seven seniors knew nothing about theater. Today, they have tried everything from writing to acting. The goal of their hard work? Seniors. Or precisely, to raise awareness on elder abuse.
The whole point is to bring entertainment, but also to bring in education and interact with the audience.
It all started last summer when the center received from the government nearly $10,000 to build a play on elder abuse. There was only one requirement. Everything had to be done by volunteers over 60. Their project was a new way to reach the center's clientele on a key issue.
Awareness in itself, education is always a fundamental part. So the more that anybody can do to bring this topic into the open so that everybody is aware of it, the more, the better it is.
Here at Marcel Ferrand Nursing Home, assistants also believe abuse is an issue to be taken seriously. And theater might be just the perfect tool to set the discussion.
Parce que de dire qu'on s'assoit à table, parler de violence, c'est comme, ouais. Tu sais, là, les gens se sentent tout un petit peu craintifs. Tandis que présenté par une pièce de théâtre, on voit la mise en situation, puis là, ça nous permet d'échanger sur la mise en situation.
Archambault and Bellemare would both like to see the play performed at their own nursing home. Archambault has already seen a similar project in a former home, but she believes the age of the participants adds a little something to the play.
Fait que c'est vraiment, comme on dit, c'est la personne concernée qui est comme acteur. Fait que la force d'impact avec des acteurs de cette qui vraiment qui est ciblée, mais je trouve que ça doit être un plus pour cette pièce de théâtre-là.
Theaters from the South Shore have also shown interest into the project. Some of them are even looking forward to present the play on their own stage next summer. I'm Karine Guillet reporting Outside the Box.
Thanks for joining us for another view from Outside the Box. I'm Jordan Amore.
And I'm Carly Yuck. Join us next time for a look at the wild world of the deep sea.
People are strange when you're a stranger. Faces look ugly when you're alone. Women seem wicked when you're unwanted. Streets are uneven when you're down. When you're strange, faces come out of the rain. When you're strange, when you're strange, when you're strange.